So take it away, Vincent.
Sounds good. I think before we get started, would it be okay? Yeah, the screen sharing. I might.
Should be good now.
Perfect. Awesome. Cool. So I'm just going to share my screen and get some of these controls out of the way. So you can all see my screen, I take it. Is that
Yes.
true? All right. Great. Great. Yeah. And of course, please do stop me if I do say something nonsensical or if there are any questions. But I'm just going to dive right into it. So, like Mark said, thank you very much for inviting me. I think this is a nice opportunity to talk about some SDP stuff. I know that you guys have been going over that in the course, so hopefully this is going to be kind of like a nice supplemental kind of overview of how you might be able to solve semi-definite programs in Python if that's something that you want to do. So this here that you see on my screen is just a Jupyter notebook. So all of this is hosted on my GitHub repository here. So I've kind of put in links for certain things that I'll be talking about throughout the talk in case you want to consult anything. So this repo right here, later, if you want to go through, check it out. All the code I'll be going over, all the notes will be accessible here. So if you miss something, just check this repo out, download it, and you can follow along that way. So I'll just close that guy there. So in this talk, we're going to be looking over how we can solve SDPs or semi-definite programs in Python. And like Mark mentioned in the introduction of the talk, there are a number of solutions for this in, let's say, MATLAB. So there's a very nice software package called CVX, which is kind of a library for solving SDPs in MATLAB. And it's really nice. It's written by one of the two authors, Stephen Boyd, who is kind of the main author on this convex optimization textbook that you might be familiar with. And it's great because it allows you to take a convex optimization problem that might look something like this and put it into MATLAB code that looks pretty similar. It allows you to specify these problems and numerically solve them in kind of a high-level way. So I've used this quite a bit in my own work, and I know Mark has as well. Some of the downsides to this particular library, though, is it's used in MATLAB, which one downside to that might be that it requires a license. So if you're a student, obviously you probably have access to MATLAB and you can reap the benefits of having a MATLAB license. But if you're not a student, or if you're just an independent researcher, or maybe you just can't get your hands on a MATLAB license, it becomes a little bit cost prohibitive to actually, make use of this software. It's really a shame because it's a great piece of software. There are also some other aversions you might have. I know this is a computational physics course, so maybe your background, maybe you have like more of a programming background, and maybe you, prefer other languages like C or C++ or Python, and you might prefer coding or expressing your ideas in a language like one of those that I mentioned as opposed to MATLAB. So it's a great thing. It's a great tool, and sometimes you just need to use a hammer when you have a nail in front of you, but there are other options on the table. So the option that we're going to be looking at in this video here is this CVX Pi module. So this is kind of the main documentation page for CVX Pi, and you can tell from the name it's CVX with Python. So this documentation page just gives you kind of an overview of what you can do with it, and it's essentially the same thing. It's a high-level library that you can use in Python that allows you to express any convex optimization problem and numerically solve them. So if Python is kind of your language of choice, then this is a very nice way to approach these problems. And it's also written by, I believe, the same author, Stephen Boyd, is also involved in some of the core development of this package. So it's real good stuff, and I use it very frequently. So, and of course, it's open source, yada, yada, yada. So all of those are nice benefits to using this over maybe the MATLAB alternative. So,
Vincent, sorry.
yeah, go
I'm
ahead.
going to zoom in a bit on this page.
Oh, yeah, of course. Let me.
Thanks.
Is that
That's perfect.
perfect? Okay, good. Sorry about that. I'll
Sure.
kind of make it a little bit bigger there. Cool. Any other questions, by the way? Anything else? Cool. So, I'll just keep going here. So, SDPs, some indefinite programming, I'm probably going to say some things that you already know based on the course that you're taking with Mark. Some indefinite programming, as you know, is a generalization of linear programming. So linear programming optimization technique where you're trying to optimize over linear constraints. Some indefinite programming, same idea, but you're trying to optimize over positive some indefinite matrices. It's a powerful tool in many different fields, machine learning, finance, and also a field of quantum information, which I know that many of you know Mark has a lot of experience in that field. And I've also worked in that field a little bit as well. So it's a really useful tool. We'll talk a little bit more about that specific applications a little bit later in this talk. They're efficiently solvable SDPs in polynomial time. So that's really nice if you if you're able to specify your problem in a way that lends itself nicely to being solved by an SDP. And their software packages, like we'll talk about today, the CVXPy package. So what we're going to be looking at are kind of the form of SDPs that I believe that you're familiar with based on the notes that I've seen from Mark are kind of this primal dual pair problem of the standard form of SDPs. You may see these primal dual problems written in a slightly different way depending on your source material for semi-definite programming. For instance, the convex optimization book by Stephen Boyd writes the primal dual problem pairs in a slightly different way, but it's equivalent to the way that we see it here and the way that you have it in your notes. So this is just kind of like put here as this is the way that we're going to be kind of specifying SDPs. And it's also kind of nice too, because I don't see this form used in a lot of examples for the software. So if you're kind of curious how to translate some of the SDPs you may encounter that are written in this form, hopefully this notebook will kind of give you something to latch onto to look at some examples for how to take problems that look like this and write them in code that you can solve numerically. So let's actually talk about solving these SDPs in Python. So I'm going to make a couple assumptions. And again, if these assumptions aren't true now, then you can follow along in the notebook that I have on my repo that I showed earlier, and you can have all this stuff set up. So first, you'll need Python, which you probably have installed in your machine already, but you want to make sure that it's Python 3.6 at least. I think they're at Python 3.9, if not Python 4 at the moment, so 3.6 or greater. And then the other thing that you'll need is this thing called pip. So pip is basically just the way, if you're not a Python programmer or have little to no experience in Python, it's just the way that you can install third-party packages in Python. So you can install things like CVXPy and anything else that other people have written into your Python environment. So we'll be making use of that as well. So the two modules that we'll be making use of in this notebook here are CVXPy, which I mentioned before, and NumPy. So we're not really going to be using a whole lot of what NumPy offers. It's a very extensive Python third-party module. It's used for all sorts of numerical calculations. You can do a whole ton of things that are very useful, things that you would probably generally do in MATLAB. And actually, there's a very nice, I probably should have posted a link to this, but there's a very nice mapping of code in MATLAB and code in Python and NumPy. So if you're a MATLAB programmer and you want to figure out how to do something in NumPy, there's a very nice kind of one-to-one mapping of how you would do certain things. So we're going to scratch the surface of what this library really offers. We're just going to kind of use a piece here and there. But basically, we're just going to use it to kind of encode vectors and matrices. So keep it fairly simple. So let's talk a little bit more about the CVXPy module. So the CVXPy website, which we went to already here, based on the description of the website for CVXPy, it's a Python module. It's a Python embedded modeling language for convex optimization problems and allows you to express your problem in a natural way that follows the math rather than in the restrictive standard form required by solvers. So basically what that means, that it's a high level way that you can take an SDP and you can sort of one-to-one mapping the SDP that you see in front of you that's written in math, and you can take that, put it in Python and solve it. So it's kind of a nice way to do that. And it's more general. It's not just SDPs, but it's convex optimization more generally, which is nice. So kind of a little bit of a downside to using CVXPy to solve SDPs was this thing that I found here. So if you look at the examples page on CVXPy, you've got a whole ton of really cool examples, things that, you know, pop up in machine learning, some advanced applications, derivatives, a whole bunch of things that are really cool that you can solve using CVXPy. But one downside is that if you look at the example for SDPs, you've got kind of a minimal example. It's really, this is pretty much all you have to latch onto, you know, for solving SDPs in CVXPy. So if you want to, let's say in the course, maybe you have a problem that you're working on and you want to encode it in Python, you know, you have this, which is a great starting point, but it doesn't really get too deep into the weeds in terms of what you can do if you have an SDP that's like arbitrarily more complex than this one. You also notice that the way in which they're specifying the SDPs is kind of with respect to the way that you might see it in the convex optimization text that I mentioned earlier. But again, this formulation is totally equivalent. So a little bit minimal here, but what I hope to do in this notebook is to kind of showcase a few other examples so that way you can see how these SDPs are specified and maybe take your own examples, whether it's in your own research or in the course, and use you know, Python to encode them. So what I'm going to do now is just kind of some logistical work, which is just setting up your Python environment. So setting up the third-party modules that we'll need to make sure that you've got everything you need to actually run the examples in this notebook. So I mentioned you'll need Python 3.6 or greater, you'll need pip, and you'll also need CVXPy and NumPy. So if you have pip installed, and I'm sorry for the Python programmers in the audience, if this is a little bit too remedial, we'll be moving on to some more advanced things. So I'm very sorry if this is things that you already know. But basically, we're just using pip to install third-party modules like CVXPy. So I can run this inside of the notebook. And in this case, it basically says I already have it installed on my machine. If you don't have it, it will go ahead and install it. Do the same thing for NumPy. So I'm just running those commands in a command prompt. So if you're in Windows, you'll pop open the command window, you pop in those commands, it will install your third-party packages and you'll be all set to go. And just kind of as a sanity check to make sure that once you've installed those things on your machine, you can go ahead and open up a Python script. So using your favorite Python editor or text editor, or even following along in this notebook, just want to make sure that when you import these things, once you've installed them, you don't get any errors. So I just ran it just now. I don't know if you saw that, but I ran it, didn't see any output. So that kind of indicates that both of those modules were installed successfully and we're good to start actually encoding some SDPs. So as kind of a baby example, we're going to take a look at some simple SDPs and how we can take them and encode them into Python. And we're going to take a look at the following primal problem that we see right here. So this is a really trivial problem. You know, you would probably never ever want to numerically solve this because it's kind of self-evident what the answer is. But again, it's kind of more for, you know, just as an example. So in this primal problem, we're maximizing the inner product between this, which is the identity, the four-dimensional identity matrix with some variable x. And we want to subject that to two constraints, that the x variable is equal to the identity matrix, the four-dimensional identity matrix, and that x is also a positive sum indefinite. So pretty simple. We should probably be able to look at this and just kind of see that the only X that would be able to satisfy this particular problem would indeed be the four-dimensional identity matrix. And the optimal value of this particular problem is going to be 4, which is just the dimension of the matrix. So pretty, you know, again, you'd never want to numerically solve this probably, but we're going to see how we can take this and encode it in Python. So we'll start off just by importing the modules that we need. So CVXPy and NumPy. So I'm going to import CVXPy like we did before and then import NumPy as NP. This is kind of a convention you'll see in Python where you can use this, this identifier to access some of the methods and functions that are present in the NumPy module. And we'll see how that looks in a little bit. But this is just kind of a Python convention if you've never seen this before, if you're not familiar with that. So looking back at the SDP, we want to do a few things. And maybe the first thing that we want to do is we want to define this variable X, the variable that we're going to be optimizing over in our SDP. So what we can do for that is we can use the built-in variable class that CVXPy provides to us. So we're using this dot operator here, which is kind of a way that we can tap into, again, the classes and methods and functions of the CVXPy module. And we're saying that we want to invoke this class variable And variable takes a number of arguments, some of them optional, one of them being non-optional, which is the size of the variable. So is this a vector? Is this a matrix? In this case, we want the size of our X variable to be a four-dimensional matrix. So we're feeding that in as a tuple of numbers here. So we're saying that we want the variable to be of size 4x4. So we're basically just defining that, and then we're storing the object itself into this variable called xvar. So now we've defined this CVXPy variable that we're going to be using to define our SDP. So the next thing, let me just kind of scroll back up here to this primal problem. The next thing that we want to do is we want to figure out some way that we can specify this objective function. So we want to find some way of defining this maximization. So if we scroll down here, we can basically just do that by running this line here. And I'll kind of unpack this a little bit. So again, what we're doing is we're calling this maximize class that's offered to us from CVXPy. Notice the dot operator there. And the maximize class takes in an argument, which is what we're trying to maximize. And what we're trying to maximize in this case is the inner product between the identity and the variable x. And I'm writing that in terms of a trace instead of an inner product. And as you probably know from the course, that the inner product that we have here is equivalent to this formulation here, where it's equivalent to the trace of X conjugate transpose times the four-dimensional identity matrix. So I'm basically just writing it in that way because it's a little bit more convenient to do so. CVXPy has a method called trace, which is what we're calling here. And inside of that trace function, we're popping in what we actually want to take the trace of. So we want to take the trace of the conjugate transpose of the X variable. So you'll notice that I'm using this dot H here. So any CVXPy variable is going to have a method for called dot H, which essentially is allowing us to take the conjugate transpose of that particular variable. And then we're multiplying that by this 4x4 identity matrix. So I'm just using the NumPy module that we installed up above to invoke that 4x4 identity matrix. And then you may or may not be familiar with this operator here, this at symbol. In newer versions of Python, it's preferred to specify matrix and vector multiplication with this operator as opposed to the standard asterisk. So if you're using scalar multiplication, you would use the asterisk as you normally would. But for matrix multiplication, we're going to use this symbol here. So if you're curious about that, that's what that is. So we pack all that into the maximized class that's provided to us, and we store the result of that into this variable that we're calling objective. So we've got our variable, we've got our objective function. And so let me just scroll back up to the problem at hand. We've got two constraints that we want to encode. And those two constraints, just going to scroll down here, are we want to enforce that the variable X is equal to the identity matrix, and also that X is positive semi-definite. So how do we take those constraints and encode those into Python? So the way that we do this, the way that you specify constraints in general for any convex optimization problem in CVXPy, is it accepts them in the form of a Python list. So right now I'm defining an empty Python list that I'm calling constraints, and I'm just setting that equal to an empty list, which will populate with the constraints here. So we'll go ahead and take those constraints one by one. So the first constraint, we just want to enforce that the variable X is equal to the identity. And the way we can do that is just through this expression here. Basically, I'm just enforcing that the X variable that we defined up above, which again is of type CVXPy variable, is equal to the 4x4 identity matrix. And notice that I'm taking, I'm calling this append method. So if you're not familiar with Python, anytime you want to add something to a list, there's a built-in method called append, which allows you to just append the contents of whatever you pass into the function into the list that you're appending to. So we're just appending that as the first constraint. Probably something I should have said a little bit before was that np.identity gives you this matrix here, which is the 4x4 identity matrix. Probably would have been helpful to see that a little bit earlier, but I digress. Okay, so what's the second constraint? The second constraint is we want to enforce that X is positive semi-definite. So the way that we can do that is by adding yet another constraint to our list, again, using the append method, and we can append that this variable is positive semi-definite. So this, these double chevrons here with a zero is indicating to CVX pi, it's the way that we tell it that we want to consider this variable to be positive semi-definite. So that's all we need to do there. So again, pretty nice and direct mathematical way that translates fairly nicely to the code. So once we've got our two things, the constraints list and the objective function that we defined, we take both of those objects and we pop them into yet another CVXPy thing, which is called problem. And it takes both the objective function and the constraints. And then we can take what this returns to us and store it in a variable that we'll just call problem. And we can do all sorts of things to this problem variable. Once we've defined it, we can solve the value of the SDP. We can also take a peek at some of the values of the variables that were present in the SDP. We'll take a look at how to do all that just a little bit. So let's actually take a look at that. So what I'm doing here is I'm defining a variable called value, and I'm just using this built-in method of any CVXPy problem, which is .solve. So I'm just calling the .solve method on the problem instance that we defined up above, and I'm just printing that out. And you know, surprise, surprise, we get a value of 4, which is what we expected, but it's good to know that the numerical implementation of this seems to agree with our intuition. And then another thing that we can do if we're curious, perhaps not just about the optimal value that the SDP gives to us, but maybe we're curious about, you know, what is the value of the variables that we were optimizing over? What did the SDP solver kind of arrive at for the values of those variables? And in this case, there's a built-in method for any CVXPy variable object called value, which we can just take a peek at that variable. So once we've solved the problem, we can call the dot value method on that. We can see that indeed, as we suspected earlier on, the value of the X variable should be equal to the identity matrix for this to make sense. So no real surprises there. For completeness, everything's kind of laid out here. So if you prefer to kind of see everything just kind of in one sort of snippet, it's all here. So you can just take a look at that. It's also, you know, I probably peppered this with a little bit too many comments to really take away from kind of the conciseness of the code. But if you look at the, you know, SDP, and if you look at the code, it should be fairly, consistent between the two implementations, that is the math and the code, which is kind of nice. Just a slight deviation on the example that we saw before. We can take that SDP that we had before and we can, you know, perturb it in a slight way, where instead the subject to constraint here is we're enforcing that X is equal to the minus identity. So in this case, we're not going to get the same values that we got before. In fact, this particular SDP, the way that we defined it, isn't feasible. And we should get an optimal value of minus infinity. So kind of a slight variation, just wanted to showcase that, you know, it does deal with SDPs that, are infeasible or feasible. And if you run this code here, it basically just, maybe this shows the more concise nature of this SDP with the code. If you run this, if you print out the value, you get minus infinity, which is what you expect because this SDP is infeasible. So that's it for kind of the baby examples of SDPs and how to take these sorts of objects and encode them in Python. And now we're going to take a slight detour into some of the applications of SDPs in the quantum information. And I want to start this off by just saying, you know, I know this computational physics course kind of brings a lot of, you know, it's an eclectic group. There's a lot of people from lots of different domains. And if you don't have any interest in quantum information, then I'm going to try to obscure as much of it as possible so you can just kind of appreciate the problem itself in isolation. And I'll throw Mark under the bus. If you have any questions about any of this, Mark is the guy to go to because he understands this stuff very deeply. But I will just say, if you are interested in quantum information, SDPs are a fantastic tool to have in your back pocket. And kind of the reason for that, without getting into too much detail, is because quantum information really consists of three main things. It consists of quantum states, consists of channels, and it consists of measurements. These are kind of the three primary objects that you will encounter in quantum information. And all three of those objects can be expressed as positive semi-definite matrices. So it's kind of natural if you want to phrase any problem that you encounter in quantum information with respect to any of those three objects, that you can kind of phrase interesting problems that you might want to solve in quantum information. And SDPs allow you to, you know, numerically arrive at certain solutions to many of these problems. And you'll see SDPs all over the place if you, you know, take a look at any of the literature in quantum information. So very useful tool. But of course, even if you're not interested in quantum information, SDPs, as you saw from the example page, they have applications in lots of other domains as well. So that was kind of an aside. But the problem that we're going to take a look at here, which is what we're going to use an SDP to solve, is this problem, which is called the fidelity. The fidelity is just kind of a notion of how close two quantum states are to each other. And if you don't care about this definition with respect to quantum states, then you can just refer to these two entities, rho and sigma, as just density matrices. So they're just matrices that happen to be positive sum indefinite and have a trace of one. So you can obscure all of the quantumness out of it if you want to. And the textbook definition of the fidelity between two density operators or two quantum states is defined as this quantity here. So it's the trace norm, that's where this one is coming from, of the product of the square roots of the rho and sigma. So you might ask yourself, like, you know, if you can calculate the fidelity in this way, why would you ever want to solve it using an SDP? This is just kind of a point I'll brush under the rug and say that, you know, the fidelity function can be solved this way, but it can also be solved using an SDP. Sorry about that. It can also be solved using an SDP. So why you might want to do that is a little bit beyond the scope of what we're going to be talking about here, but that's just what it is. So we're really just going to be interested in what does the SDP for solving this problem look like and how do we encode it in Python? So that's pretty much what we're going to do. We're going to take a lot of things for granted here. So let's just take a look at, for the sake of example, two quantum states or two density matrices. And just as I mentioned earlier, the fidelity is kind of it's a measure of how close two quantum states are to each other. So the quantum states I'm defining here, rho and sigma, are identical. So I've defined them to be the same matrix. So you can verify that both of these matrices are indeed positive sum indefinite. And if you were to calculate along the diagonals, the trace is equal to one. So these are in fact valid density matrices. So we'll take these as kind of the example once we implement the SDP and once we implement the calculation, just to make sure that you know, we get a value that we expect. And I should also say that since the fidelity is a measure of closeness of quantum states, it's a value that kind of goes between zero and one, where one is, you know, the closest they can be with respect to the measure of the fidelity, and zero is as far away as they can possibly be with respect to that measure. So if we're using these two states here, we should expect a value of one from the fidelity. So this is yet another thing that is a little bit beyond the scope of what will be going on in this notebook, but I've included references if you wish to follow up on why this is the case. But it turns out that you can write the fidelity in terms of an SDP where the primal problem of that SDP is given to us right here. So it maybe looks a little bit awkward, a little bit weird with respect to the way that we've defined the fidelity, but just take it for granted that someone gave you this SDP magically and said, here's an SDP, I care about solving it. It solves the fidelity function, and I want you to numerically verify that this actually gives you the same value that maybe some other piece of code does. So let's just say that you're tasked with that example. So, okay, so we want to take this SDP, this primal problem at least, and encode it into our Python environment. So we're going to see some things that we saw before, but we're going to see some things that we haven't seen before too. You'll notice that this matrix here is basically a block matrix where the diagonals are rho and sigma. So those are the blocks that correspond to the diagonals. And then the off diagonals are these X variables. So we're going to see how we can use CVXPy to specify a block matrix and enforce that block matrix is positive sum indefinite, which is, you know, something that comes up fairly frequently if you're solving SDPs of another flavor. So good to know how to do. And some of these other things will probably be somewhat reminiscent of what we saw up above in the initial baby example. So let's start off by just importing the necessary libraries that we need. So we'll import CVXPy and NumPy just as we did before. Just to kind of align with the states or rho and sigma that we defined up here as rho and sigma, I'm defining them in Python using NumPy. So I'm defining the I'm essentially defining the matrix rho here and the matrix sigma here. So this is just the way that we can define matrices and vectors using NumPy. So it's kind of a nice concise way for us to specify these types of objects. So now that we've kind of got what we want to input into the SDP, we need to actually go ahead and formulate the SDP. So the first thing that we'll do is we'll take a look at how we can define the variable. So the variable X that we're going to be optimizing over in our SDP. So like we saw before, we have this variable thing that we can define, and we're passing in two arguments this time. So the first one should look similar to what we passed in before. I'm basically just using this built-in method called shape, which just gives me a tuple. So if I run row.shape, it gives me a tuple corresponding to the dimensions of the matrix row. So this is equivalent to just passing in 4 by 4. So that's very similar to what we saw before. But just in case we have like a general example where the states could vary from 4-dimensional to 8-dimensional to 16 or whatever, I'm just kind of writing this code in sort of a more robust way to keep it a little bit more general. The other thing that you'll see that I'm passing in here is complex is equal to true. So this is basically telling CBXPy, hey, I want to allow the entries of the variable X, they might be complex. So by default, this is set to false, but I'm essentially saying, hey, this is something that we want to allow. And this kind of comes from the fact that these are quantum states. So once we've defined this variable, we'll again store it into something we'll call XVAR. And then the next thing that we want to do to scroll it up back to the actual primal problem, we want to encode this objective function. Okay, so we've got 1/2 times the trace of the variable X and then something similar. So going back down to the objective function here. So we again use the maximize class that we did before. And we pass in, just like we did before, CVXPy's trace method. And we're passing in two things, 1/2 times the X variable, which we defined up above, and then 1/2 times the conjugate transpose of the X variable. So notice that we're using the .h method as we did before in the baby example. So that allows us to take the conjugate transpose of any CVXPy variable object. Now, notice another thing I'm doing here is I'm wrapping that whole expression in CVXPy real. So basically what that's doing is it's just taking all of the, it's taking what we get from the trace and it's just converting it from a potentially imaginary value to a real value. And that's because we can't have, we can't have an objective value that's going to be imaginary. It's gotta be real valued. And indeed, if we get rid of this real function on the outside of this wrapping here, we'll see this error that pops up here, which basically says, hey, the value, it needs to be real. You can't have an imaginary optimal value. So that's basically where this is coming from. So we've specified our objective. And now the next thing that we want to do is we want to specify these constraints. So again, we've got a block matrix and we want to define that block matrix using CVXPy and enforce that that whole thing is positive sum indefinite. So going down here, I'm defining, like I did before, constraints list. So a list of constraints. And in this case, there's only one entry in the constraints list, which is going to be the block matrix. So CVXPy has kind of a built-in method called BMAT for block matrix, where you can specify, here's the first block, here's the second block. So this is kind of the first row. Maybe if I write it, let me just kind of put it like that. So it's a little bit more close to what you would see like the matrix written as, where you have the diagonal blocks as rho and sigma and the off diagonal blocks as XVAR and XVAR conjugate transpose. And then once we define that, we just want to make sure that the constraint itself is enforcing that this whole thing is positive sum indefinite. So we've seen that before. We're just using the double chevrons with the zero to indicate, hey, we want to enforce that this is positive sum indefinite. So we've got our objective, we've got our constraints. And then we take those two things, we pop them into the CVXPy problem class. And this is going to yet again give us an object, which we'll call problem, which is returned to us based on how we specified the SDP. So in the example, if you recall up above, I'm popping in both of these rho and sigma variables. So these matrices are identical. So we should expect that the fidelity should give us a value of 1. So if I call the solve method on the problem that I specified up here, indeed I get a value that's essentially 1. There's a little bit of error here because, you know, some of these things aren't perfect, but rounding to, you know, quite a few decimal places, this is effectively 1. And indeed, if we were to actually just go and solve the fidelity function as we originally specified it, so let me just scroll up to remind you what that looks like. If we solve it with respect to this expression here, so the norm of the square roots of the matrices rho and sigma, and if I scroll down here, this is us essentially just taking those two matrices and basically just calling, running the trace norm on those two variables. So you can see that I've taken those two matrices up here. I'm taking the square root of the first one times the square root of the second one. I'm specifying that my norm in this case is 1, so the trace norm. And I'm just essentially using NumPy to calculate the norm of that expression, and I get 1. So it's kind of what we expect. So we've got a SDP that gives us the same value of something that we defined up above. So yet another example of how you might want to you know, numerically solve some of these things. This is also a little bit beyond the scope, and it's also a bit of a shameless self-plug. But if you are interested in quantum information, and if you are interested in SDPs, and if you are interested in Python, so it's a very small subset of people, you know, I'm not gonna make any friends at a bar, I guess, whenever they open, but you can check out this Taquito module. This is just a kind of a collection of software tools that someone who is interested in solving certain problems that pop up in quantum information might want to use to numerically arrive at you know, certain solutions. And it turns out, as I said before, a lot of problems in quantum information lend themselves very nicely to being specified and solved through SDPs. So if you check out this link here, this just takes you to the software package. You can check that out. It's all open source. It's on GitHub. And if you're curious about other examples of SDPs that pop up in the quantum information literature, there's a list here of all of these SDPs with corresponding links to where they are also implemented in the Taquito package. So if this notebook maybe didn't quite do it for you in the sense that you want some further examples to see how you can solve other problems that pop up in different fields, well, in this case, specifically quantum information, then you can consult this list. You can go check out that code, and hopefully that gives a little bit more context for solving some of these things. And that's pretty much it. Just got some references at the bottom, and yeah, that'll do it.